Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Leap to Leader, How Ambitious Managers Make the Jump to Leadership, by Adam Bryant. Narrated by Michael Butler Murray. Chapter 1. Do You Really Want to Lead? When Penny Hersher, a veteran tech leader in Silicon Valley, stepped into her first chief executive role when she was 36. She thought she was prepared. That confidence soon evaporated. After 6 months, I realized I had no clue how to be a CEO, she said. I just kept finding myself in situations where I didn't feel like I had the experience and the tool set to know what to do, and I kept waiting for permission to make decisions. Then one of her board members took her aside to give her some coaching. You're looking to the board for permission, he told her, and you need to understand that we're going to give you advice, but you have to make your own decisions. Because if we give you bad advice and you follow it, we'll still fire you. Phil Martins remembers vividly the day when he heard the news that Lehman Brothers was declaring bankruptcy, just one of the many implosions of the 2008 financial crisis. At the time, Martins was running an automotive supplier that was preparing to go public, and the shockwaves from the Lehman announcement would ultimately scuttle that plan. Martins was driving to work when his chief financial officer called, and Martins started to laugh at first, because he assumed his colleague was joking. As the news sank in, Martins pulled off the highway and just sat there, wondering what he would do. When his CFO called him back an hour later to ask him what they should do, Martins said, I don't know. After a few similar experiences in his career, he came to refer to them as stoplight moments, and he counsels up-and-coming leaders to prepare for them. You're going to be driving home one day after some big new challenge came up at the office, he said. You're going to get to a stoplight, and you're going to start realizing that you don't know what to do. And then you're going to realize the stoplight's been green for a while, and you've been staring off into oblivion. That's when you realize how lonely the job is. Earlier in her career, Mary Elizabeth Poray built a reputation as a reliable fixer at the consulting firm EY. The more broken, the more complex, the more difficult the situation that needed to be turned around, I was the person who was called, she said. That strength became a payoff for me, like a drug. But at some point, she realized that to move into higher leadership positions, she couldn't keep doing all the work herself. I had to figure out what to let go of in order to lead, added Poray, who is now the firm's global deputy vice chair, client technology. Time is finite. And so how you spend your time becomes incredibly important. So I looked deep in myself and said, what are the things that I couldn't possibly think about giving away? And I gave them away. These are just a few of the countless ways that people experience the leap to leader, a jump that has little to do with your title and everything to do with your mindset. It is a realization that you are fully accountable, that you must grapple with the hardest decisions, and that you need to let go of doing the work that earned you promotion after promotion earlier in your career. It means writing the playbook for your job, rather than running the playbook that your bosses hand you. It means imagining what could and should be, rather than delivering on expected outcomes. It is about understanding that leadership is not a popularity contest, and that earning people's respect matters more than having them like you. It means setting a compass for a new direction and letting others create the roadmap for executing the plan. It means unlocking the potential in people that they may not even see for themselves. It is about giving credit to others and taking blame when things go wrong. It means always doing what is best for the organization, even if that requires letting go of valued colleagues. It is about having the courage to take a stand, even if it costs you your job. It means thinking about what you can do for people, rather than what they can do for you. It is about building other leaders, not just followers. For some, the leap to leader can be exhilarating, just as it was for Margaret Heffernan, a serial entrepreneur who is also a best-selling author and popular TED Talk speaker. When Heffernan worked at the BBC, early in her career, she had to spend a lot of energy working through the thickets of rules that had built up over decades at the government-run broadcaster. There were policies nested in other policies, nested in other policies, nested in other policies. And you have to be very careful how you navigated through them all, she said. She left the BBC when she was 36 to take the leap into her first CEO role. And there was a moment as she was settling into her new job when she asked her assistant about the company's policy on a certain issue. She turned to me and said, "It's whatever you say it is," Heffernan recalled. And I thought, whoa, this is really going to be fun. It was absolutely liberating. But for others, as Heffernan has seen time and again with the executives she has coached, that freedom can become overwhelming. As you climb the corporate hierarchy, you're constantly constrained by what you can and can't do, she said. You have your job description, your goals and targets, and your boss's goals and targets. And when you get to the top, you have quite a lot of freedom, but you haven't ever had that before. Many people who find themselves in leadership positions can feel a bit like the cage door is open, but nobody's confident to go through it. The reason is that the constraints in their minds are so profound and ingrained. They have had such long careers of looking for approval that the idea that they can think freely for themselves takes quite a lot of getting used to. That transition can take some work. The goal of this book is to provide an intensely practical guide to making that transition by sharing insights, stories, and approaches from hundreds of leaders to build the skills you will need to make the leap to leader. Starting with proving yourself as a manager, then advancing to more senior roles to increase your impact, and finally, making the fundamental mindset shifts that are necessary to succeed by understanding how you need to be as a leader. This book is meant to be a companion to my most recent book, which I wrote with Kevin Scherer, the former CEO of Amgen. The CEO Test, Master the Challenges That Make or Break All Leaders, published by Harvard Business Review Press in 2021. The leap to leader is about becoming a leader, and the CEO test is about what you need to do in those roles to succeed as a leader. There are no cookie-cutter formulas, and everyone must chart their own path to leadership, given that it requires so much interior work, including wrestling with who we want to be and become as a leader. There are infinite complexities to leadership, and for the past dozen years, I have taken a journalistic approach to better understanding them. By now, I have interviewed more than 1,000 CEOs and other leaders for the Corner Office feature I created at the New York Times and for my interview series on LinkedIn. From the start, I have steered clear of asking any questions about their organization's strategies, to focus instead on the most crucial leadership lessons they have learned over their careers. Since joining the Exco Group, an executive mentoring and leadership development firm, in 2017, I have worked with hundreds of high potentials whose employers are betting on them to be their next generation leaders to help them navigate some of the toughest challenges of leadership. And I have conducted extensive interviews with dozens of mentors at our firm about the key themes that come up time and again as they advise senior leaders who are moving into even bigger roles. From all those conversations, clear patterns have emerged about what it takes to make the leap, and the leaders have shared with me compelling insights, memorable stories, and practical tools and approaches for putting their insights into action. I am not trying to boil the leadership ocean in this book. There are dozens of topics that I could discuss in each of the stages along the leap to leader. And I have enough material from the roughly 8 million words of my transcripts to fill several books. My focus instead is on exploring the X factors that will have the greatest impact on your career and in your development as a leader. Leadership is incredibly hard and nuanced work, and a win for me will be if you will come to rely on this book as a trusted guide as you move into new leadership roles. But there is a threshold question that you need to spend some time wrestling with first to be certain that you're up for the challenging climb ahead. Do you really want to lead? It is a question that should be asked more often than it is. As organizations assess and develop leaders, invest in their high potentials, and work on succession plans, they often do so with the assumption that if somebody is a high performer, then they will, of course, want to make the jump from sole contributor to manager to leader. But that thinking needs to be revisited, says Shauna Erdman, a senior vice president of talent and learning at Comcast. One aspect that we overlook sometimes is individual ambition and what a person really wants to do, she said. Often the leaders of a company, including boards and HR, will pick and choose among upcoming executives for promotion. But no one ever has a conversation with that individual first to ask them, what do you want to do? What are your ambitions? What do you see as your goals or your next steps? Or, do you want that job? So often we miss that critical piece, and then we wonder why, when we elevate someone, they might not do as well as we expected in their new role. We need to get better at having those individual conversations. So, let's have that conversation. And it should start with a reality check on what leadership roles entail. After all, many people think they want big leadership jobs until they actually start doing them. When they discover all the challenges that they wished they had known about before they raised their hand. And leadership has become many times harder since 2020, the year the global pandemic started and George Floyd was murdered, setting off tsunamis of wholesale change across society and the corporate landscape. The pandemic accelerated digital transformation at light speed, upended old notions about whether people could work productively at home, and made humanity, compassion, vulnerability, and authenticity, not to mention an ability to thrive in the ambiguity of relentless disruption, the qualities that separate leaders. Heightened awareness of racial injustice has led to pressure on organizations to make bolder commitments to diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging. As huge swaths of the population shifted to working from home, we spent more time contemplating the meaning and purpose of our work, which led not only to the Great Resignation, but also to a growing sense among employees that they should have a voice, if not a vote, in setting company policies. Leaders now must prep for all-hands meetings as if they were politicians, ready to field questions on just about any pressing issue facing society. When, where, and how should you take a stand on various issues? What do you do if someone asks you to set aside the corporate talking points and share your personal belief? In this era of stakeholder capitalism, leaders must work through difficult conversations with many more constituents who often have competing demands. Younger generations of workers are rewriting the employer-employee contract by asking not what they can do for their companies, but what their companies can do for them. They want to work to live rather than following the live-to-work ethos of previous generations, a big part of the hashtag quiet quitting movement. But they also want their companies to be more reflective of their personal values. It's a new world across the board, said Ryan Ruslansky, who took over as chief executive of LinkedIn 3 months into the pandemic. Everyone is hungry for corporate executives to show up on every critical issue in the world. If that's the job description for leaders today, what is your gut check as you hear that list of new challenges? Do they strike you as a set of endless headaches and make you run for the exits? Or do you see them as fascinating challenges and an opportunity to build new models of leadership at a time of breathtaking change? If you are nodding your head yes in response to that last question, and you feel inspired to take on the many challenges of leadership, then let's proceed to the question of why. And I don't mean that skeptically. I'm posing that question as an exercise in self-awareness, a topic I will explore later in the book, so that you are clear about your motivations. Can you step outside yourself and interrogate your desire to lead? Is it to make more money and enjoy the bragging rights that come with a bigger title? Do you want power? If the answer to those questions is yes, then you should pause and consider the hard-earned lessons of many executives. The money will not feel like it's enough to offset the sacrifices you will have to make in these top leadership roles, and you will be flying into a stiff headwind if your goal is to wield power, because command and control leadership has fallen out of favor. So, what does drive people to lead and to choose the harder paths in life that mean longer hours, tougher problems, and greater exposure to risk and failure? It is one of the many questions I have tried to answer through my conversations with leaders. In those interviews, I often spend time asking about their childhoods and early influences. Were they in leadership roles early on? What kinds of things did they do outside of class? How did their parents, or whoever raised them, influence their leadership style today? Dealing with adversity in their younger years was a big driver for many. They faced some hardships early on, financial challenges, or an abusive or alcoholic parent. And many were quite open about those stresses, having to grow up quickly as a child, and being motivated in their adult years to create a greater sense of control in their lives. I also met a lot of mold breakers, including immigrants and children of immigrants, who built track records of doing things for the first time in their families, such as going to college. Leadership roles for them were a natural outgrowth of always having to rely on themselves to navigate new challenges and overcome obstacles. To be clear, I don't think that hardship is a prerequisite for success. I met many leaders who spoke of comfortable childhoods and prosperous families, and business became the focus of their quick minds and seemingly boundless energy. But if there is a single thread that runs through leaders, it is this quality of being drawn to the fire, a phrase that has come up often in my interviews with leaders. Rather than wanting to avoid hard challenges, like figuring out when and how their companies should weigh in on various social issues, they are excited by them, and they see them more as opportunities than problems, more energizing than draining. If somebody isn't interested in leading during a period like this, and hopefully learning from it, then they probably aren't the right person for the job, said Anne Mulcahy, the former CEO of Xerox, who now serves on many boards, including as lead director of Johnson & Johnson. The exciting part is that you can define the role and shape it, perhaps much more so than in the past. And I find that tremendously exciting for leaders who have an appetite for that. Does that describe you? Not every moment of every day, of course, but most of the time? The point is to be honest with yourself and clear about why you want to lead, because that why will sustain you through the most difficult moments when you may wonder why you signed up for all these challenges in the first place. It's okay to have doubts. Leadership is not binary. It is not a question whether or not you are a leader, and some leadership roles may appeal to you more than others. Because of the circumstances of your life, you might be more or less inclined to take on a bigger role during different phases of your career. Leadership is complicated, so you should not be surprised to have a complicated relationship with leadership. That has been the case in my own career, as I have moved in and out of leadership positions. At times, I was running departments at the New York Times and Newsweek, and in others, I was second in command. When I interviewed John Donovan, the former CEO of AT&T Communications, he shared that he also felt some ambivalence about leadership. I don't feel a burning need to be in charge, and I don't feel that it's a bad thing to follow when the right things are getting done, said Donovan, who now runs Quidit, which invests in technology firms, I just derive great satisfaction from a well-played plan. I don't think anybody should thoughtlessly try to get the top job without putting some thought into what kind of leader they want to be. How am I going to measure my own results? Like Donovan, I have never felt a particular need to be in charge. But I will step in if I sense a void that needs to be filled. We joke in our family about the camp counselor gene. If people are standing around in a circle, wondering what to do, we will step up as needed. My goal in all my roles was to help coach the writers I worked with to do great work, build new skills, and strengthen existing ones. That was my why in the 15 years I spent as an editor. And I have a similar goal in this new chapter of my career as a consultant, to help people become more effective leaders. I share all that as a close-to-home example of how and why it's important to be honest with yourself about why you want to lead. Because all the qualities I mentioned earlier that are becoming increasingly important in leaders today, authenticity, humanity, humility, mean you must check your ego at the door and be self-aware of your goals and motivations. We are in an era when it seems like any question is fair game for employees to ask of their leaders. So, imagine if you were on a stage in a town hall meeting, and someone raised their hand and asked, "Why do you want to lead?" What would you say? Before we jump into the next chapter, on building a solid foundation as a great manager, here are a few framing thoughts to keep in mind as you listen to this book. You will be hearing from dozens of CEOs and other C-suite leaders. And yes, in almost every case, it has been many years since they themselves made the leap to leader. But the memories of their own jump are still vivid. And from their vantage point, they can spot clear patterns of what it takes for others to become leaders and to succeed in those roles. You will also meet 7 leaders in this book who are rising through the ranks and will share their insights and stories in extended Q&As, starting with Marcus Kennedy of Intel at the end of this chapter. If you are working on making the leap to leader yourself, I'm betting that you will see yourself in some of their stories. While they work in a range of industries and represent a diversity of experiences, they all share key qualities. They are self-aware, thoughtful about leadership, and were willing to be open about some of the challenges they faced as they've grown as leaders. In the spirit of building self-awareness, you might consider reflecting on how you would answer some of the same questions I ask of these leaders. My goal was to write a book that would be useful to everyone who is interested in leadership, regardless of where they are in their career. My hope is that there will be many new insights and approaches in these chapters for you, and even if you've heard some of them before, perhaps they will serve as timely reminders, not only for yourself, but to pass along as you mentor and develop other leaders. I always try to start conversations about leadership, not end them. And that includes the conversations you will have yourself as you reflect on whether the ideas and techniques resonate for you personally. While everybody will consume this book differently, I'm confident that the distilled wisdom of hundreds of leaders in these chapters will make you feel both stronger and wiser as you navigate the infinite learning curve of leadership. So if you're up for the challenge of making the jump to leadership over a chasm from which everything you've done prior has not prepared you, as Donovan describes it, then let's get started with building a solid foundation as a great manager. Leader Profile. Marcus Kennedy, General Manager, Gaming Division, Client Computing Group, Intel. The hardest part is making tough choices that have real impact on employees. Adam. What were some important early influences that shaped who you are as a leader today? Marcus. The first is that I was born 2 months early. I wasn't supposed to make it through the night. My parents tell me that the doctor said, if he makes it through the night, then we've got a good shot to make it to the end of the week. By the end of the week, they said, if he makes it through next week, then we've got a good shot to make it to next month. The lesson, as my parents have often reminded me, is that time is precious. I do everything that I can to make sure that I don't waste my time. So I'm impatient. But I like to say that impatience can be a virtue too. The second biggest influence from a drive perspective is that I'm a younger brother. And like many younger brothers, I'm super competitive. And that includes video games, which were an early passion of mine, and where I found that I could beat my brother consistently at something, even though he's 4 years older. I became good enough to do it professionally for a time. My love of video games started early. I had to make my tokens last at the arcade, so I learned to beat these kids who were much older than me, so I could play all day long. The third big influence was that my dad and mom always instilled in me this idea that I could write my own ticket, meaning make my own path to whatever I wanted to do. But I didn't know what I wanted to do early on, so I realized that I needed to learn as much as I could about the world around me and figure out which ticket I was writing. What was your first management role? It was at Kraft Foods in Illinois. I was 23. I had interned with them for a few summers prior, and I had a black belt in Lean Six Sigma. They asked me if I would be interested in taking a manufacturing shift supervisor position. The average age of employees I was going to be managing was about 40. I learned that I had to earn their respect, admit that I didn't know everything, and that I was there to listen and to support them. Once they realized that I was not a threat, and that I was there to help them, we got along well. Did you figure that out right away? No, I had read a couple of books on leadership, including Sun Tzu's The Art of War, and I treated work like a battlefield. I was subconsciously positioning the people I was supposed to manage as my enemies. I tried to learn as much intel as I possibly could about them so that I could strategically position myself to win the battle. And they sensed that immediately. Within the first 2 weeks, people were taking extra breaks and not communicating with me. I didn't know the system, so I couldn't hold them accountable. I quickly learned that my approach was completely wrong, and that I had to support them and figure out how to help them do their jobs. When I started asking them questions to figure out what they needed, things turned around within a couple of months. After 6 months, our shift was beating the others in terms of productivity. What was the biggest challenge in making the leap to leadership as you've moved into more senior roles? The hardest part about leading a very large organization is not knowing the details anymore. I'm intensely curious. I like to dive into things, learn as much as I can, and be hands-on with solutions. You can't do that when you're leading a very large organization, when you've got to focus more on providing direction, inspiration, and vision, removing roadblocks, and having regular check-ins. That was a very hard jump for me to make. Did others help you through that process? I learned a long time ago to ask questions and pick people's brains. People love talking about themselves, and they love sharing what they've learned. And I want to learn from other people's mistakes, so I don't have to make them. I try to have as many mentors as possible, people who have done what I'm doing, people who haven't done what I'm doing, and people who may have opinions on what I'm doing. As I shifted into more strategic leadership roles, I sought out a lot of people, and I was never disappointed by the advice. I didn't always follow it, because it didn't always fit my approach. But I got enough input that it allowed me to try different approaches and see what worked. It accelerated my ramp up into this kind of role. At this point in my career, I've been able to make the switch to understanding that my job is really other people, to make sure they have everything that they need to succeed, from the right strategy and vision to the right resources and the right capabilities. And sometimes that means moving them to a job that better matches their skills. So I focus all my time and effort there. In what ways do you want to be a better leader 2 years from now? In every way. And I don't say that facetiously. But if I had to pick one, it would be agility. It's a fact of life in very large companies that it takes a long time to shift and change direction. Once you do, there's a lot of momentum you can build, and you can really drive long-term value and success. For me, it's about trying to build that agility and to fight against that natural instinct of people questioning youth and lack of expertise. The world moves much faster than an organization can, so we've got to be able to be more agile. What do you think is the hardest part of leadership? Let's start with what I don't find hard. The cornerstones of authenticity, trust, and transparency are relatively easy for me. They weren't always. I used to think that I needed to present a certain kind of persona at work. But I learned to be the exact same person in every situation, even while changing styles or skill sets to fit the situation. The hardest part is making tough choices that have real impact on employees. I don't make those decisions easily. I would like to do everything I can to protect everyone's job, but we have to make the right call for the business. That's probably the biggest challenge. It's a privilege to have that responsibility, and I don't take it lightly. One of those moments came after I had built a high-performing team over a couple of years. I personally handpicked about 80% of the new team. And not only were we nailing all the metrics, but everyone genuinely liked each other and played off each other's strengths. Unfortunately, we had to cut back across many of our business groups, including mine, due to a recession. Even though our part of the business was growing, we had to let a handful of people go in order to meet our financial goals. Those were emotional decisions and conversations, but I tried to bring a sense of transparency, fairness, and personal respect to the process, which people seemed to appreciate. If you were speaking to a group of younger managers, what advice would you give them? Challenge yourself. I've always tried to prioritize continuing to learn in my career. But I haven't always made the most aggressive decisions, like taking an overseas opportunity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.